afternoon. I'm Albert Carnishill, Dean of the John F. Kennedy School of Government, and it's my privilege to welcome you this afternoon and to introduce to you our speaker, His Excellency Turgut Özal, President of the Republic of Turkey. President Özal's career is noteworthy for its variety and its success. Having been trained as an engineer myself, I'm pleased to note that he too studied engineering. Following graduate training in the United States, he returned to Turkey to plan and implement the electrification of his country. In the 1960s, while serving in the military, President Özal worked with the Scientific Advisory Council of the Ministry of National Defense and helped found the State Planning Organization. During this period, he somehow found time also to lecture at the Middle East Technical University. This ability to combine teaching and professional practice is a characteristic that we seek in Kennedy School faculty. The Kennedy School also values innovative approaches to solving real problems, and President Özal has demonstrated that skill as well. For example, he brought together the government and the marketplace to organize and finance Turkey's hydroelectric power network. In the late 1960s, President Özal brought his technical skills to the Prime Minister's office. His experience in formulating and implementing the development of Turkish industry, agriculture, and exports are instructive to any student of industrial policy. He recognized full well, even then, the importance of a broad-based and international approach to local economic problems. Continuing this internationalist approach in the early 1970s, he served as an advisor to the World Bank, focusing on several large industrial and mining projects. He then returned to the Prime Minister's office, where he was responsible for Turkey's international economic relations and for the economic austerity measures that rescued his nation from near bankruptcy. His economic package brought inflation down from over 100% to less than 25%, doubled Turkey's exports, opened up its domestic markets to foreign competition, ended shortages at the bazaars and gas pumps, and rekindled the growth in the gross national product. In 1983, he established the Motherland Party, and following his success in the general elections against the party backed by the military, he became Prime Minister of Turkey. In 1989, after a second term as Prime Minister, he was elected by the Turkish Grand National Assembly as the 8th President of the Republic of Turkey and the nation's first civilian president. Since that time, Turkey has emerged as a strong regional leader. Just last year, an 11-nation gathering in Istanbul brought life to President Özal's idea of creating a Black Sea Economic Cooperation Pact with a market of 400 million people to complement the European community. During the Gulf War, President Özal was in constant contact with President Bush and, in addition to other support to the coalition, allowed the coalition access to Turkish air bases. Turkey has close historical and cultural ties with Bosnia, and last month succeeded in having the UN General Assembly pass a non-binding resolution calling on the UN Security Council to take stronger action in that region of the world. Turkey is also an important link to the republics of the former Soviet Union through its cultural, economic, and political ties to that region. In these changing times, with barriers between nations falling while new ones are being created, Turkey's position as a link between East and West is of critical interest to the United States and to the world. Our speaker today is expected soon to meet with President Clinton to discuss matters of mutual interest to our two countries. Please join me in welcoming the President of the Republic of Turkey, His Excellency Turgut Özal. Mr. President.
Ladies and gentlemen, First of all, I would like to thank Kennedy School of Government to give me this opportunity to talk in this prestigious school. Ladies and gentlemen, the events in the regions around us continue to unfold with undiminished pace and significance. With the end of Cold War and the transformation of the international landscape, the bipolar world ended. We hoped that countries around the world would leave aside their differences and concentrate on bringing prosperity to their peoples. It was thought that the new emphasis in international relations would be on reconciliation and cooperation. But instead, what we see are new and different forms of conflict. Perhaps far more complicated than the Cold War era. From Afghanistan to Bosnia, there have emerged conflicts pitting people against one another. A strong sense of nationalism, reminiscence of the later half of the 19th century, is reaching threatening proportions. The dust has not finished settling from the collapse of the Soviet Union. The Russian Federation itself contains structural elements of instability. The struggle between the liberal reformist groups and the reactionaries seems to be escalating. The Russian government appears to have taken a more hardline approach to protecting more than 25 million ethnic Russians now living outside the Russian Federation. On the other hand, the search for identity of the non-Slavs inside the Russian Federation confronts a Russian government that seems unsure of the best approach towards the issue of minorities within its borders. The Northern Caucasus is in flames. There has been savage fighting in southern Ossetia. The civil war in Georgia continues as the Georgians and Abkhazians engage in bloody fighting. No end is sight in the war between Azerbaijan and Armenia. I need not to tell you the situation in which Turkey finds itself. We are a democracy committed to Western values, stranded in a sea of uncertainty, encircled not only by the Balkans and the Caucasus, but also by Iran, Iraq, and Syria. Turkey is the oldest and strongest democracy to emerge from the Ottoman Empire. The fall of the Soviet Empire has placed Turkey in an unusual position, one in which she can help introduce contemporary democratic values to countries long denied them. Ladies and gentlemen, Turkey wants to help the Central Asian republics. They will need a counselor in the transformation into secular democracies, a stabilizing influence during their economic adversity, and a catalyst for democratic modernizing change. We consider many people in Central Asia our kinsmen. They share our history and culture, and basically speak our language. We were the first country to extend diplomatic recognition to to the new states of Central Asia and were also the first country to establish embassies in them. Turkey is willing to work with states of Central Asia and finds it that increasingly the leaders and peoples of these new states are looking to her as the role model Turkey believes it can be. Ladies and gentlemen, Turkey also knows a thing or two about economic transformation. Turkey began this century as part of a far-flung empire. Anatolia, aside from the larger cities, was largely agricultural. There was next to no industry, except perhaps some artisan manufacture. Although it was never colonized, the Ottoman Empire, under the Sultans, relied heavily on Western industry and know-how rather than building its own economic base. After the declaration of the Republic, Turkey began to rebuild like those of many industrializing countries. Turkey's economy became first centralized and relied on import substitution to build an industrial infrastructure. By the end of 1970s, it was clear that for Turkey to advance economically, she would have to replace central authority in the marketplace with market force. The parallels with the experiences of Central Asia are obvious. I made it my mission in the 1980s to preside over a dramatic transformation of the Turkish economy through an ambitious program of economic reforms. Turkey has begun to set new standards for economic growth. Among other things, we are well along on a program of privatization. We have lowered all barriers to foreign investment and actively welcome foreign participation in our economy. We see our future, particularly given Turkey's location in international trade, as a linchpin in our regional market and as an active economic partner to our friends and allies like the United States. Having accomplished its economic transformation, Turkey can utilize its location at the crossroads of Europe, Asia, and Africa to the benefit of itself and its neighbors. We have undertaken several initiatives that will benefit many of the countries around us, economically and politically. In October 1992, the heads of state of Azerbaijan, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan came to Ankara for a summit. This summit was the first to bring together all of the former Soviet republics of Turkic heritage, and therefore quite significant. In November, another important meeting took place in Islamabad. At that meeting, Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, and Afghanistan joined Turkey, Pakistan, and Iran in the Economic Cooperation Organization, ECO. This provided an important link from Turkey deep into Central Asia. As part of our bilateral efforts to assist Central Asia, we have established technical assistance programs in communications and transportation. A satellite communications link has been established to broadcast Turkish TV and radio to Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan. Telephone calls from these republics to the rest of the world are now possible largely due to satellite-to-ground link set up by Turkey in these countries. Turkey has provided these services free of charge. Turkish Airlines provides another important link to the outside world for them. In all, we have signed 47 cooperation agreements with countries from Belarusia to Tajikistan. Bilaterally, the assistance provided in kind by Turkey to the Turkic republics amounts to substantial sums. The Turkish Exim Bank has extended credits to them worth $610 million. We feel we could extend more credit to them. However, there are certain practical difficulties, as there are few channels through which the credits could be channeled. Another important step we have taken in this respect is the establishment in 1992 of the Turkish International Cooperation Agency, TİKA. TİKA is an autonomous organization with a separate budget responsible directly to the foreign minister. Although its geographical zone of operations covers a wider area, it places special emphasis on assisting the progress and growth of countries sharing the Turkish culture and heritage. In the framework of cultural relations, 10,000 scholarships were made available to those countries for the 1992 academic year. There are almost 7,000 students in Turkey taking advantage of this program. In order to help them adopt the Latin alphabet, we set up a very modern printing press in Azerbaijan, which will also service the other republics. There are frequent exchanges of scholars and scientists. We also provide training positions for banking, insurance, diplomacy, and public administration. The private sectors in Turkey is increasingly interested in doing business in Central Asia. In fact, joint ventures with Turkish participation have already been initiated there, and small and medium-sized businesses have been set up in the Russian Federation also. Before concluding this portion of my remarks, let me say this. The area is going through a great transformation, and the political turbulence that enabled those states to achieve their independence could also easily destabilize them. The ethnic structure, such as the existence of Russian minorities in all of the republics, coupled with the artificiality of the borders drawn by Stalin, even though they have now gained international legitimacy, is potentially explosive. These problems can be further exacerbated by worsening economic problems and the lack of political institutions or democratic experience. They need our assistance to move forward towards healthy, prosperous democracies. Yet no single country can carry the burden of helping them. A concerted international effort is urgently needed. I now would like to move to a similar subject, which is the Black Sea Economic Cooperation. We put forward the Black Sea Economic Cooperation Project with a view to developing and diversifying existing economic relations among the Black Sea countries by making efficient use of the advantages arising from their geographical proximity, their traditional ties, and the complementary nature of their economies. Turkey was also motivated by the conviction that the Black Sea region, with its vast resources and industrious population, had a great potential to develop into a weighty economic center if the countries of the region worked together. Albania, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Bulgaria, Georgia, Greece, Moldova, Romania, Russia, Ukraine, and Turkey all signed the founding document, the Istanbul Declaration, in June last year. Poland has been given observer status, and a permanent secretariat will be established in Istanbul. The Black Sea Economic Cooperation will help the participating states to encourage free enterprises and democracy. The BSEC, Black Sea Economic Cooperation, comprises fields from transportation, communications, information technology, standardization, and energy, to tourism and health, and science. In these areas, the governments will identify and carry out joint projects to develop regional infrastructure. With Turkey a member of the Economic Cooperation Organization, ECO, that I referred earlier, as well as having close economic ties with Western Europe, the Middle East, and the Mediterranean, we hope to be the focal point in providing expertise in the administrative, bureaucratic, judiciary, economic, and commercial fields. Turkey's goodwill towards its neighbors is clear, as it is commitment to being stabilizing influence in its region. Economic stability and democracy are necessary for regional peace, and we are making every effort to promote them. In our overtures to Central Asia and the Caucasus, and the jump-starting of our relations with Eastern Europe, we hope we are working to resolve and preempt conflict. Ladies and gentlemen, there is a growing frustration among the Turkish public at the inability or reluctance of the world community to stop the gross injustices occurring in Bosnia Herzegovina. Turkey has been trying to spur the international community to no avail. The world community, and the United Nations in particular, has been too slow, too ineffective in dealing with this issue so far. Time to act is rapidly running out. Ethnic cleansing is continuing in full force. Concentration camps have been established. Mass murders, atrocities, rape of girls and women of all ages have become commonplace in Bosnia. Already 200,000 people have died, and almost 1.5 million have escaped to other countries. And all this is happening in Europe at the threshold of the 21st century. Ladies and gentlemen, while Yugoslavia was falling apart, I was hopeful that its disintegration could be achieved through peaceful means, like it has been the case for the Soviet Union. In fact, the presidents of Macedonia and Bosnia had told me that they would favor a loose federation rather than independence. A political solution was possible at the time. However, at the insistence of Germany, the European Community recognized Croatia and Slovenia, and the events started to unfold. Balances have been disrupted. After the war began in Bosnia, now Mr. Vance and Lord Owen are trying to impose a plan based in reality on the gains of the victors, that is the Serbs. Such a peace cannot be long-lasting. A political solution will be possible in Bosnia only if it is based on a balance in the battlefield. And I believe this can only be achieved by taking the following measures. Arm the Bosnians. The Serbian army has inherited all the weapons of the ex-Yugoslav army. They have not affected by the armament embargo. But the Bosnians have only light arms. Their 130,000 men need to be armed. So the embargo needs to be lifted for Bosnia. Once the embargo is lifted, there will be no need for ground forces from third countries. The UN no-fly zone needs to be enforced effectively. Serbian heavy weapons should be handed over to UN control. If this is not done, they should be destroyed through air operations. I think these measures will enable the Bosnians to save their country. It is really up to the United States to take the initiative towards this end. Europe has shown that it is helpless in this situation. Ladies and gentlemen, I would also like to say a few words about Iraq. The invasion of Kuwait and the Gulf War has confirmed that wars sometimes do not solve the problems. Instead, they create new problems. The special circumstances of Iraq after the war also aggravated the magnitude of the problems. Saddam Hussein is still in power, in spite of the many humiliations he suffered, and he continues to challenge the resolve of the UN. A consensus between the different ethnic and religious groups in Iraq has not been achieved since Iraq gained its independence. There was no integration of the people. In fact, just the opposite happened. You might remember that when Iraq gained its independence, it had guaranteed the rights of the Kurds and the Turkomans living in the north. It was this guarantee that laid the basis of Mosul Vilayet being given to Iraq rather than to Turkey. But these promises were never kept. Kurds were massacred on several occasions. Ba'ath Party is a secular party. But during and after the Gulf War, the regime is getting to be more and more intertwined with religion for obvious reasons. The Gulf War has brought out all these differences and contradictions of Iraq and its people. And because Saddam continues to stay in power, the Iraqi people cannot solve their differences through dialogue and consensus. Let me tell you, the Turkish case is an illustration of what can be achieved in a parliamentary democracy. We are committed to the promotion of democratic and human rights, including the rights of our citizens of Kurdish origin, to preserve and develop their ethnic identity. Today, only 35% of Kurdish citizens live in southeastern Anatolia, whereas 65% have moved on their own free will to the West. In short, integration of the peoples of Turkey is well advanced. That is the reason of the democratic regime of Turkey. This cannot be seen in other type of regimes. Neither this integration is possible in Iran nor in Iraq. Ladies and gentlemen, I have always advocated democracy for Iraq. Of course, a solution is not easy to find, but I believe a long-term strategy needs to be adopted. The tactics used lately will not solve the problem. Whether we like it or not, the question of Iraq has become a question of the world of democracy, because Saddam Hussein, with his every move, is challenging the democracies, so it is up to them to find the solution. Ladies and gentlemen, beginning with the second half of the 1940s, the U.S. support for Turkey initiated an era of friendship and close cooperation between the two countries. There was almost a perfect coincidence of U.S.-Turkish interest in the following years. As regards the evolution of the international landscape, today the landscape is changing radically. However, the Turkish-U.S. interests coincide more than ever. Indeed, Turkish soldiers fought beside the American soldiers under the UN flag in Korea in 1950s. As the world is now in search of a new order, Turkish and American soldiers are once again together under the UN flag in Somalia. Turkish-US cooperation during the Gulf crisis was exemplary. Turkey is prepared to act in Bosnia with the US. These are specific examples of the coincidence of our interests in a changing world. I believe there is great potential for deepening and enriching our relations. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. President. The President has graciously consented to spend some time answering questions from the floor. There's a microphone here, there's one there, and there's one up there that I can see. So if people would get by the microphone, I will try to recognize them. We have little time, so I do ask that try to keep your questions brief and try to make sure that they're questions.
Good afternoon, President Ozal. My question is three sentences long, and I thank you for your coming to Harvard and speaking to us today. I am an American who just returned from a 10-month assignment in Armenia working for the United States government. I worked out of an apartment that was 14 degrees Fahrenheit indoors because there was no heat, no hot water, no electricity, and no working phone lines due to the energy blockade brought on by its neighbors, and all of this on the verge of the 21st century. As America's neighbor and vital link to ocean ports, are you prepared to commit the government of Turkey to securing unrestricted passage of humanitarian aid and energy through your borders into Armenia and not as infrequently as you have allowed to date? And if yes, could you give us a little bit of details on that, please?
Let me tell you what Turkish relations with newly formed independent states of Armenia. We have recognized all of 15 independent states, including Armenia, all together. We have not separated. As you can see also, we have initiated Black Sea Economic Cooperation Project, and that includes also both Armenia and Azerbaijan. And Ter Petrosyan, who is the president of Armenia, came to Turkey and signed the declaration. The unfortunate thing is the conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia, not between Turkey and Armenia. Even Turkey considers that good relation with our neighbor Armenia will also give chance to us, especially the diaspora Armenians, will not work against Turkey. That was our intention. But this relation between Armenia and Azerbaijan sometimes makes some problems difficult. Why? We have roughly 4 million Azerbaijan origin citizens of our country. They consider very important ethnic group in Turkey. Second, in spite of these differences, the fight between Azerbaijan and Armenia in Karabakh, Nagorno-Karabakh, what we have done it. For example, we have given, I think it was free of charge, 50,000 tons of wheat to Armenia. This was not very well accepted by Azerbaijan. They said, why you are helping to our enemy? We have decided, under my proposal, to give electricity to Azerbaijan, Armenia, because next to us. Again, there was political forces inside Turkey. Why you are doing this? And government stepped back. But I am sure, what I believe, the first thing is to solve, in my opinion, is the conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia. I think it makes both countries vulnerable. And it makes both countries' people suffer. But it is very difficult, not easy, because it comes from historical relations. I told to the president of Azerbaijan, I said, you have to get a better relations with Armenia. Why? It's very simple. If you do this, probably from Central Asia, the roads, oil pipelines, gas pipelines will come through Caspian Sea to Azerbaijan, and a small portion will pass through Armenia and to Nakhchivan, which is a part of Azerbaijan, then to Turkey. This way, you will have a lot of economic development. That means the Central Asian countries will be connected to Europe through Turkey. You will get a lot of advantage of this. But sometimes it is very difficult to explain what you are going to gain this type of cooperation. But be sure, we are doing what is in our hand, utmost, to make this problem between Azerbaijan and Armenia solved. I know what you have said. I know what is happening in Armenia. I know what is happening is also in Georgia. Unfortunately,
I'm sorry, President Ozal. From all accounts, in the former Soviet Union, there is no republic in the entire former Soviet Union that is in the same condition as Armenia is. So Georgia is not a comparison, and Armenia is not at civil war.
No. Have you seen Georgia? Have you seen Georgia?
I am not at odds with Georgia. That was not a negative comment about Georgia. It was merely a clarifying comment.
Yes, but I told very clearly that I think we are doing utmost to solve the conflict between Azerbaijan and Armenia, and also trying to help all the republics of old Soviet Union.
Sir, with all due respect, you did not answer my question, though. Excuse me.
I answered. Thank you.
Please. Next question.
Mr. President, I'd also like to thank you for speaking to us today. My question regards Turkey's economic liberalization. The success of Turkey's economic liberalization over the last decade has relied on its access to international capital markets and Turkey's ability to attract foreign investment. How do you see the future of foreign investment as a force for Turkey's economic development?
I think the foreign investment in Turkey will be much more important and will be much more forthcoming because of the change of the economic landscape of Turkey. Today, compared to 1980, Turkish lira is convertible. And cambio and exchange system is very free, even freer than some European countries. Third, there is a growing market of 60 million inside Turkey. And also, Turkey is a center of many surrounding countries through these new economic cooperation agreements, like ECO or Black Sea Economic Cooperation. And I feel we will be, maybe by 1996, as a custom union with European community. That will also open up to foreign investors a larger market, which has a population of 300 million to the investors. Fourth important factor, I think communication. And also hard-working people of Turkey. That will provide basis for any foreign investment to make efficient operations. Thank you.
Yes. Mr. President, can you hear me? Mr. President, in your remarks, you said that you would encourage investment of capital in Turkey. And there were Armenians from the United States who wanted to open a railroad or road from Armenia via Turkey to Trabzon. And that was eventually canceled. Can you comment on that, please?
No, Turkish opinion is that the railroad which you mentioned does not go to Trabzon, first of all. There is no railroad connection to Trabzon in Turkey. That railroad, which Russian railroad, have a different width compared to Turkish railroad. What happens at the time of the Soviet Union, only the railroad cars comes and exchange, the goods is exchanged to the Turkish railroad system, which has different size of cars. And then this system will go from Turkey to maybe Europe through the Ankara-Istanbul Railroad. Only port is available in the Black Sea area is the Samsun, not Trabzon, first of all. Second, I am in favor of opening up not only this rail connection, but at the same time, trading possibility at the border. We have done with Iran, with Syria, with some other countries, and we have already done with Georgia, and we would like to do with Armenia. But you should realize also, there are ethnically, I said, 4 million Azeris in Turkey. They have some pressure to our government. But to complete the question, we are not going to stop or hold the humanitarian aid to Armenia.
Good luck.
Mr. President, I want to come back to the economic transformation. As you might be well aware of, we are both here at the Kennedy School and at the Business School, are obsessed, what I mean by that, we study over and over, the changing role of government and the private sector in promoting economic growth. My question to you is, what has been the role of the Turkish government under your leadership in making Turkey internationally more competitive?
I think the simple formula which is applied in case of Turkey to get less government, less bureaucracy, less decision making by the state and give this opportunity to the people of Turkey. That was the main formula. Yes, I know it was very difficult because bureaucracy in Turkey, as far as I believe in everywhere, same bureaucracy, once he gets some kind of power, he doesn't let that power go from his hand. To give you one example, some years ago, in 1929, when we had the world crisis, and Turkey is also affected, and then Minister of Finance decided that they are going to protect Turkish lira by law, and they pass a law from the parliament, giving jail sentences to the people who carry foreign exchange, foreign goods, which they think they imported. We worked with this law almost 55 years. They did not let. And I remember there has been cases, if you caught with $1 in your pocket, you will be jailed. And they say this was the protection of Turkish lira. This did not protect the Turkish lira. You cannot protect your money through by law. This is the economic system. I mean, economy is the main thing. I said this, we are going to change it. But it was very difficult to do it. As I said, 50 years of experience. I called somebody from the Minister of Finance and I said, I am going to change these rules, but I am going to change it in 3 years. You give me one set of things, regulation, which I may be applying in 3 years' time. And then at the end of the 3 years, what I am going to do, which would be much more freer, and give me also that. I know what I am going to do. And they prepare both regulations. I implemented the second one, not the first one. Thank you.
Mr. President, also thank you for coming to our school. I'm a student here. I listened very carefully to your comments about Bosnia and how much you are concerned about the ethnic cleansing that is happening there. However, for 18 years now, Turkey has invaded the island of Cyprus. Cyprus is the only country on earth now that has occupying forces. You do not abide by the UN resolutions, and yet Turkey is a model country of democracy. The same is happening with human rights within. The latest report by the State Department said that torture is exercised, people are vanishing, everything is going worse and worse. Would you rather comment what do you see in the future happening? Is Turkey going to change its stance on Cyprus and on human rights?
I think, first of all, coming to the subject of Cyprus, I think you pointed out this subject is in the last 18 years. But don't forget that it is much older than that. I think it started during 1950s, when Britain decided to leave the island. And as you know, there was Ioka in the island fighting for an independent state in Cyprus. But there was two communities. One is larger, is the Greek Cypriot community. The other, Turkish Cypriot community. They have lived centuries together in the island. And in 1950s, we sit down with Greece, Turkey, and Britain, decided to form a unique government in Cyprus. But this government should be a kind of cooperation or jointly formed by the Turkish Cypriots and Greek Cypriots. In short, the president should be from the Greek Cypriots, vice president with veto powers should be from the Turkish Cypriots. And the government post ministries will be divided 7-3 ratio, 7 from the Greek Cypriots, 3 from the Turkish Cypriots. And all government important posts will be divided according with this ratio. You know, this is signed in London, Zurich. These are the agreements. And also we guaranteed together with Greece, Turkey, and Britain, the constitutional guarantee, a kind of constitutional guarantee for this new republic. And there was one Turkish unit, army unit, and one Greek army unit in the island, in both sides. What happened? In 1963, the late president of Cyprus, or the first president of Cyprus, Makarios, decided that he cannot govern Cyprus with this formation of constitution, and he kicked them, all Turkish people, from the government. Vice president, and also all the ministers, and he started to rule only by the people elected from the Greek Cypriot sides. This was done in 1963. From 1963 until 1974, there was a big misery of the Turkish Cypriots in the island. They were kicked out. They were forced to leave the island. There were killings. And United Nations came to island, not in 74. They were the Green Line, which is dividing Nicosia, which was established in 1963. That means this subject is not 18 years old, it is almost 29 years old. Now, what has happened in 1974 as the Turkish intervention to the island? The Greek colonels in Greece decided to make enosis with the island. And they prepared a coup d'etat. They toppled Makarios, the president, and decided that, I think it was named was Samson. He will announce the unity with the Greek mainland. At that moment, Turkey, coming from the rights of the London-Zurich agreement, intervened. We asked to Greece and Britain whether we can jointly intervene the island in order to restore the old regime, They have not accepted. And we have the right to intervene the island. We intervened. I know what has happened. Now, Turkish people, Turkish Cypriot is on the north, the Greek Cypriot is on the south. And this thing continues almost, as you said, 18 years. The problem is not easy to solve it. And we are in the opinion to find a solution. This is the Turkish interest. But problem is the safety of Turkish Cypriots, because they have seen very hard lessons during the between the 63 and 74. Today, with the Turkish army on the northern Cyprus, since 18 years, there has not been a single incident. Under the protection of Turkish army, no fight between Turkish Cypriots or Greek Cypriots. And Greek Cypriots are very much prosperous. Today, I can tell you that the Greek Cypriots had a per capita income well over of Greece. And I don't think from now on they want to join with Greece mainland, because they are better off. There is another thing obtained with the 74 Turkish army movement. Because of this movement, the Greek colonels were toppled and the democracy returned to Greece. Thank you.
Your Excellency, we welcome you. And we really appreciate your honest and eloquent addressing many questions. But I have one another which you haven't mentioned. It's the water. Water is very important for Turkey and for the Middle East. And also Turkey has taken very ambitious and multidimensional project, which is called GAP Project, or Southeastern Project. My question is, now you're going to meet our President Clinton. What would you like to see that the United States to help the Turkey to utilize efficiently and effectively its water resources for the Turkey and to the Middle East? Would you make a comment, please?
I think Middle East, especially in the area to south of us, including Syria, Jordan, Israel, Saudi Arabia, and Kuwait, Emirates, these are countries very short of water. I think main problem, as one of the Middle Eastern statesmen said, the war in Middle East from now on will not be for soil, it will be for water. Turkey has, yes, water resources. And the famous rivers, which is mentioned in the Bible, Euphrates and Tigris, originates from Turkey. And roughly 90% or 95% of waters of Euphrates comes from Turkey. Roughly 60% of waters of Tigris is also coming from Turkey. They become one river at Şatül Arab. They are at the Şatül Arab, is close to Nile when they join. 100 billion cubic meters yearly at Şatül Arab, or maybe a little more. There are other rivers also in Turkey, emptying to Mediterranean, like Seyhan, Ceyhan, Manavgat, very good rivers, some of them probably like a drinking water. I have proposed some years ago bringing a pipeline from Seyhan and Ceyhan rivers to satisfy the requirements of industrial and urban use of water use, two big pipelines may carry some 2 or 3 billion cubic meters of water yearly. To the one is in the east part of, up to east part of Saudi Arabia, the other is the west part of the Saudi Arabia, through the countries passing through Jordan, Syria, and the separating one side to the west and the other is east. But this type of projects, in my opinion, require some kind of stability in the area. But once the peace is reached, these projects, if it is handled, then it will also be guarantee of the peace. Because nobody wants to cut the water. Water it would be the essential. Now, providing that water, and at the same time, you can have, instead of water, the other pipelines, such as gas or oil. If these pipelines, electric lines, crosses the countries, every country in the Middle East will depend upon each other. And then they will not be able to cut those lines because they will cut their throat. And therefore, peace would be strongly established in the area. But first step is to get some kind of agreement. And I can tell you, for the irrigation purposes of Euphrates and Tigris, that's a different subject, I found it very, with the modern techniques, especially Israeli use, drip irrigation, there will be sufficient amount of water in both rivers to satisfy the demands of Turkey, Syria, and Iraq. Nobody should worry.
Mr. President, being dean of this school comes with both responsibilities and privileges. One of the least pleasant responsibilities is calling this afternoon's event to an end because the schedule doesn't permit any more questions. But one of the great privileges is getting to thank the audience for their provocative and thoughtful questions, and especially you for your thoughtful remarks and your candor in your responses. Thank you very much. Thank you.